Sunday morning, June 18, 1972. The Washington Post ran a news story about a break-in at the Democratic National Committee headquarters in Washington, D.C. In the coming months, men would be tried by Congress for alleged wrongdoing in the case that would unfold into one of the biggest political cover-ups in United States history. A scandal that reached into the highest office in the land.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
Not only would President Nixon resign, but a number of his associates, many of them high-ranking officials in CREEP, the Committee to Re-elect the President, were indicted and sent to prison. Just weeks before the Watergate break-in, an up-and-coming political organizer was offered a senior position at CREEP. Richard Richards had arrived at its headquarters in Washington for an introductory meeting, but it wasn't long before he sensed something was amiss, and he refused the job and walked out.
It's interesting because most people would not really know who Dick Richards is. And that's an indication of what a good man he was.
There were no shades of gray in Richards' approach to the political arena, which since the founding of the United States had been filled with candidates and office holders willing to do or say whatever it took for a vote, even at the expense of one's integrity and ethics.
Because you have a lot of people shooting at you, and to be able to stand up to it and do it all ethically, it was a tremendous accomplishment.
You need people who have got the courage to stand up and take it on the chin.
This is a success story of an unlikely combination, politics and ethics. It is a story of democracy in action, where doing the right thing prevails, and where honesty, in the long run, yields the best results. This is the story of Dick Richards.
Ethics is something that you either have it or you don't. It's the core of what you are. And I don't know Dick Richards' parents, but somewhere along the line, whether it was a mother, a father, a family, somewhere, someone instilled in this individual a sense of hard work, fairness, and fair play.
Richard's father, Blaine, was the first one in his family to break away from the coal mines of eastern Utah and venture out on his own. He started a sign painting business, and in Dick's early years, the business thrived thanks to Blaine's hard work and honest approach.
Dick's father, Blaine, had a reputation for being a very honest individual. He never cut corners to try and make another dollar. He always carried out what he promised to do and went the extra mile in doing it.
While working at his father's sign shop, Richards attended Weber College in Ogden, Utah. He excelled in debate and soon won the office of chairman of the Weber County Junior Republicans. It was here that his excitement for the political scene began to flower. Richards became involved in the congressional campaign for Douglas Stringfellow, a hero of the Second World War. But his excitement would soon be tempered by his first taste of the unethical use of politics.
Douglas Stringfellow was a Republican who was a veteran who had been blown up in a landmine during basic training. And he laid in the Bushnell Hospital for a couple of years, crippled. And I suppose that while he was there, he concocted this story in his mind about being a war hero. And he went around telling people about how they jumped behind the lines in Germany and captured Dr. Otto Hahn, who was the so-called inventor of the atomic bomb. Somebody in the Army Times wrote a story and said, hey, this isn't all true. Doug didn't do that.
2 weeks before the election, Stringfellow confessed his story was a lie.
Obviously, I learned then, and I have learned it again and again and again, that there are no secrets in politics. There are no secrets, period. So if you've got something in your background that is very unsavory, and you run for office, you darn well better plan on somebody telling about it.
In the 1962 election, Richards was asked by Lawrence Burton to manage part of his congressional campaign in Utah's 1st District. After a close race, Burton won and asked Richards to accompany him to Washington as his legislative assistant. In 1964, Richards returned to Utah to continue a law practice and participate in state politics. It was a disastrous year for Republicans in Utah. Utah's second district congressional seat was lost to a Democrat. 22 of Utah's 29 commissions were held by Democrats. The governorship was lost to Calvin Rampton, and the state legislature leaned heavily Democratic with solid majorities in the House and in the Senate. With Lawrence Burton's encouragement, Richards threw his hat into the race for chairman of the Utah Republican Party. He won, but there was little to be had when the dust settled. However, it was just the sort of situation Richards thrived in.
Dick has been anxious to do things to improve the community in the state. He's not been one to do it to enhance the image of Dick Richards. He has done what he accomplished to make his community a better place in which to live.
During this time, Richards worked closely with Ken Garf, who was then serving on the Republican National Committee as the representative from Utah.
Dick Richards was younger than he by 20 years, and they were politicians with a vision of where to take the state. It was not built on power, it was not built on how my career will go from here. It was built around principles that they both agreed on.
Replacing half of the executive committee with younger, more energetic appointees, Richards began redeveloping the Utah Republican Party as a party that represented a broader base of Utahns.
We never really had a grassroots kind of effort in the party. Most of our executive committee was made up of well-to-do men, the country club set, we call them. And so as chairman, I got to reorganize the executive committee, and I presume the average age dropped by about 20 years. We put a lot of young people on there who were aggressive and who wanted to do something. They wanted to win. They were not there just to have a title.
The state party chairman, something that people really don't know and appreciate, and especially when you take it in the context of Dick Richards. Now you look at Utah, and Utah, as we say, is the reddest of states. But when Dick became the state party chairman, you had two congressmen who were Democrats, a United States senator was a Democrat, the governor was a Democratic governor, and so the legislature was controlled by Democrats. But Dick was the person who really put the infrastructure together, which was really the foundation of which the modern day Republican Party has been built upon.
One way Richards did this was through an effort he dubbed the Neighbor to Neighbor program. It was simple. Female volunteers called 10 homes concentrated in the same neighborhood until they could get one person to volunteer as a local chairman. The new recruit would then approach his neighbors and strike up political conversations about specific candidates, hand out literature, answer questions, and provide a personal invitation to get to the polls and vote Republican.
In grassroots politics, you walk the streets and decide who's a Republican, who's a Democrat. And you get your fellow workers, people that believe as you do, to make sure that they come to the polls. And that takes a lot of organizational skills to do that.
And if you don't build that from the base up and you try to build it from the top down, it's gonna fail. At some point in time, you can't pour enough money and enough people around to make it happen because the people, the masses, are gonna reject it. But if you build it from the base up, it's gonna be a foundation. It's going to continue to grow, and it'll stay.
On Election Day, the Democratic Party in Utah received a crushing blow from which it has never recovered. 29 Democrats lost their seats in the House of Representatives and 11 in the Senate, giving the Republican Party a commanding majority. And on the county level, the situation perfectly reversed itself. Instead of 22 of 29 commissions held by Democrats, it was now 22 of 29 commissions held by Republicans.
The thing that's so important to understand is that who votes is, in most political campaigns, more important than how many people support candidate X or candidate Y. And a group of votes of people that might have voted can make a huge difference in who's elected and who's not.
The elections of 1968 in Utah saw Richards' momentum for the Republican Party carry through again. And on the national stage, Richard Nixon's campaign staff rolled out the Neighbors program to great effect, and Nixon won by a landslide. Despite the victory, Nixon had actually lost his home state of California in the primaries, where a rising political star had captured the governor's office just 2 years before. Now, Ronald Reagan was setting his sights even higher. Though he only captured California that year, Reagan turned a lot of heads doing it, including Dick Richards. The new Nixon administration appointed Rog Morton as the new chairman of the Republican National Committee. An acquaintance of Richards going back several years, and duly impressed with Richards' now nationally recognized track record, Morton hired Richards to work as the RNC Director of Party Development, and then, 3 months later, as political director.
People who've been around as long as we have will tell you, if they're honest, organizational politics is the bedrock. You don't build campaigns from some guy announcing at some podium somewhere and sending out bumper stickers and doing some pieces on TV. Doesn't work. He wrote something called Mission 70s, which was the first and frankly the only one I've ever seen real handbook on how to run an organization of political operations at the national level.
And it was a program designed to teach everybody that had a political responsibility how to do their job. In other words, we're talking about the precinct chairman or the voting district chairman. Here's what he's supposed to do. The county chairman, here's what he's supposed to do. The finance chairman, the public relations chairman. And we literally published a book where we told everybody what they were supposed to do and gave them a timetable.
If you work those kinds of things, it's not an art, it's a science. And if you do them as well as they can be done, as often and as completely as they can be done, you win. If you don't, you lose.
Prior to the 1970 midterm elections, Lawrence Burton decided to run for the Senate, leaving his seat in the U.S. House of Representatives up for grabs. Being a close friend and colleague, and having obtained what he thought was a fair amount of experience in Washington, Richards announced his candidacy for Burton's seat in Utah's 1st congressional district. He received support from a wide array of national figures, including George Romney, Richard Nixon, Donald Rumsfeld, and Lawrence Burton.
Hi, I'm Dick Richards, Republican state chairman from Utah. From the time I first became involved in partisan politics,
Richards sailed through the Republican convention unopposed and immediately got to work running a very adept campaign. He enjoyed a very large lead over his Democratic rival, Gunn McKay, until negative campaigning struck a hard blow to his campaign.
He was really too good. In the debates, in front of crowds, he was always quick with an answer, and it was usually a correct answer. Gunn McKay, very nice guy, and he'd come across as your neighbor. And so he tried to paint Dick as a slick-tongued lawyer.
The McKay campaign drilled Richards as a slick D.C. insider, while painting McKay as a more folksy, trustworthy local candidate. The negative campaigning turned the tide against Richards, and now he had to decide if he would retaliate or choose a higher road.
There's so many pressures in a campaign that tug and pull on an individual. And unless you have a pretty good sense of what is right and wrong, you lose a powerful base that can make a difference of winning or losing.
The other side may launch negative campaigns. And while your emotional and immediate reaction is to counter or at least defend, the best result is to get on message and stay on message. Does it always yield the successful result? It depends on how you define results. Is the most honest candidate always elected? No. Is the most honest candidate always the one that's most successful? Yes.
While Richards struggled against the negative campaigning, Lawrence Burton's Senate campaign was falling apart at the seams. He had hired an out-of-state advertising and marketing firm to handle his image, and the results were disastrous. On election day, they both lost.
I wanted to be sure that you got off a telephone call, preferably a message if necessary.
By January 1971, forces within the Nixon administration had been active for months in covert efforts to stop the leaking of classified information. Their goal was to protect the president's reputation and keep potentially harmful information from jeopardizing the 1972 campaign. Part of these operations included minimizing the RNC's role and centralizing control in a new committee called the Committee to Re-elect the President.
Richard Nixon, a man America needs.
Richards was offered a job at the committee's highest level, but he smelled trouble.
The Nixon people said, look, we want you to stay here with us, and gave me an office, gave me a spot in 1701 Pennsylvania Avenue. And I went in and I met the people involved and saw the situation, said I'm not interested, and turned around, flew home.
A month later, Richards was offered a job on the presidential campaign, which Richards accepted on the condition that he work out of his home in Ogden. He became the Western field organizer, but spurned his official instructions, which were to get Nixon elected at all costs, even if it meant diverting support away from local Republican candidates. Instead, Richards initiated the Neighbors Program and stumped for everyone in the party.
He had responsibility for most of the West, and he would travel. And we found out in a number of occasions later where they had spies following us because they didn't trust him, because he wasn't doing, quote, the campaign.
They wanted Nixon to have the greatest landslide ever, and they didn't care about governors and senators or anybody else. So whenever we found a neighborhood chairman, the big question was, are you willing to be the chairman for Nixon? And if they didn't like Nixon, but they liked the governor candidate, like somebody else, we'd pass that information on to the other candidate. Look, there's a lady that would really like to work for the governor's race. Well, the Nixon people objected to that, and I did it anyway. Because I said, look, we're going to win big. Why don't we help our other candidates down the line? We wanted to win for the party.
Despite a landslide victory for Nixon in 1972, GOP celebrations were short-lived. A few months before, five men were arrested for breaking into the Democratic National Committee's headquarters at the Watergate complex. The next 2 years saw increasing media coverage of the affair, a White House cover-up, and a full investigation by Congress that led to the resignation of Vice President Spiro Agnew, the indictment of 69 people, and finally, the resignation of Richard Nixon in 1974.
It's because they were afraid. What is it are they going to find in the Watergate offices of the DNC? We don't already know and have a better plan anyway. They didn't have the confidence of their own ability, their own issues, their own ability to make things happen.
Thank you and good evening.
Distanced from the national scene, Richards would resume state politics and begin supporting a promising new figure in the Republican Party he'd met several years earlier.
I used to watch Dick Richards and Republicans. They loved a guy by the name of Ronald Reagan. Now, Reagan looked at it in 68, he looked at it in 72, but then Reagan really becomes a hero in the eyes of the Republicans in Utah.
By mid-1975, having won a third term as state GOP chair, Richards was again asserting an opinion that wasn't aligning with many others in his camp. During the months leading up to the 1976 presidential elections, he was the only state GOP chair to endorse Ronald Reagan instead of the incumbent Gerald Ford. Many prominent Utah leaders chided Richards for his lack of loyalty to the sitting president, as well as for his apparent short-sightedness in supporting a candidate who was sure to lose.
When you have a sitting senator, half of the sitting legislature that are opposed to what the chairman of the party wants to do, you got a problem.
Nevertheless, Richards stuck with Reagan, and in the Utah Republican Convention of 1976, was influential in getting all 14 of Utah's national delegates to vote for Reagan.
The thing you need to understand is the role of state party chairman is not a compensated role. And so Dick did this on his own nickel, and he did it because he passionately believed in Ronald Reagan.
The guy that was the head of the Army, Secretary of the Army, is named Bo Calloway. And he called me over and he says, Dick, he said, let me tell you something. I know that you're for Reagan, and we're going to beat him. And if we beat him, then we expect you'll be with us. And I said, I will. And he said, you know, I have more respect for you than I do all these other sons of bitches, because he said, they're just waiting to see which side of the fence the shoe's going to fall on. That's where they're going to join. And he said, you had the courage to take your pick and make it known right off the bat.
I think the value that I appreciated most in Dick was his absolute honesty and forthrightness. In politics, people are tugged and pulled in various directions, and sometimes you have to be very careful about trying to assess what they really do mean and do intend. With Dick, there was never any question in that regard.
I would be honored on your behalf to ask my good friend, Governor Reagan, to say a few words at this time.
Reagan endorsed Ford after his defeat. Following the convention, Richards was asked to join Reagan's political action committee, Citizens for the Republic, by Senator Paul Laxalt from Nevada. The group met often to plan a 1980 run for the presidency. However, it seemed their efforts were leading nowhere.
So after a couple of these meetings, Paul Laxalt said, anybody have anything to say? And I raised my hand, and I said, yes. I said, the next battle we have is going to be a convention fight like the one we just lost. And we're not getting any better prepared for that fight than we were then. And I think we're wasting our time. And Ronald Reagan was doodling up. He was drawing a picture of a cowboy on a horse. I later saw it. And he said, that's right.
Dick Richards is not a real political, if you will. Dick will tell you exactly what he feels and how he thinks. He's not going to tell you what he thinks you want to hear.
Richards' honesty proved to be a great asset to the Reagan team and made him a valuable player as the campaign got underway. He orchestrated his Neighbors program on a national scale and would head the Reagan campaign operations in 19 states.
He was willing to get out on the ground level in the trenches. Dick was happiest being in, you know, Montpelier, Idaho, going door to door, setting up a phone bank. He was in his element, talking his way into the hearts and minds of people who were going to vote. And that kind of retail politics at the grass level, ground zero, is where elections are won. He was a master at that.
In the end, all of Richard's states, except for Hawaii, voted Reagan. Reagan's electoral votes defeated Carter 489-49. After Reagan's election, Richards was appointed transition chair for the Department of the Interior. Though he was on a short list for Secretary of the Interior, Reagan had other things in mind for Richards. Shortly thereafter, Reagan endorsed Richard Richards as chairman of the Republican National Committee.
We agreed what we would do is each of us would give our suggestions.
Dick got the position in the Reagan administration that he should have had. The Democrats controlled the House with Tip O'Neill, they controlled the Senate, and they wanted somebody who could really come in and basically go elect people who would support Ronald Reagan and what he wanted to accomplish as president.
The job of Republican National Chairman would demand a lot of an already hard-working Richards. As the head of a major political party, he would have headquarters in Washington, but would find himself working in every state over the next 2 years. With millions of dollars at his disposal, and with scores of individuals and groups clamoring for his attention, Richards would have to maintain his policy of strict personal integrity if he was to conduct himself ethically at every twist and turn.
One of the attitudes I had when I was chairman is, I'm going to do what is good for the president, number one. He asked me to be the chairman, I'm going to do what's good for him. And I know some of the guys in the White House who had high-level positions had agendas of their own. They call up all the time to an agency or even to the National Committee and say, the White House wants this, the White House wants that. You say, who in the White House wants it? You know, the White House can't want anything. Who wants it?
Part of the White House's calls were a grab at the Republican National Committee's budget. This war chest, as it was called, was perhaps the party's greatest asset.
We put money in congressional races. We put money in party building in the various states around the country. And all of the things that Ronald Reagan did that were of a political nature, we paid for.
If you don't have the resources, I don't care how good your strategy is or how good your candidates are, you've got to have the resources to present your candidate and to help many, many campaigns and many candidates financially.
With the war chest growing, Richards was now able to take on some key political challenges. He set his sights on the New Jersey gubernatorial race of 1981. But a win there wouldn't be easy.
State Chairman of New Jersey came down and he came into my office and he said, Dave, we've got a candidate in New Jersey that can win. He's the Speaker of the House. He's a talented attorney, but he has more money than deity itself. I'm going, okay. I said, that's an important thing? Yeah, because he can't be bought.
New Jersey was a bad place for Republicans. And there was a fellow by the name of Al Barkin. He was interviewed by the New York Times writer. And the writer says, Al, how did you get in politics? You've been there a long time. And he said, well, I got my first job at age of 15. I was hired by the Democrats as a voter. And he said, I went around all day voting.
Richards and his team did background research on the current roster of registered voters, and the results were astonishing. Over 200,000 people were dead, some having died more than 20 years ago. The RNC promptly filed a lawsuit contending that the names of the deceased should be removed, and the state purged the names. But as Election Day neared and the stakes rose, so too did attempts at fixing the election in favor of the Democrat candidate. It became clear to Richards that without some creative strategizing, there would be no chance for Republicans on election night.
We're going to have one heck of a victory this fall, all of us together.
We knew we would get cheated if we didn't do something. So we established the National Ballot Security Program. And we had signs about this big, like a typical lawn sign for a candidate that said, National Ballot Security Program in force here. It is unlawful to vote if you're not registered. It's unlawful to vote in someone else's name. And it's unlawful to vote more than once. And if you do any of the above, you'll be prosecuted.
We get a call from the DNC. They're gonna sue us. Sue us for what?
They filed a lawsuit against us because we intimidated voters. We intimidated voters that were gonna cheat. When they saw this sign, they left.
The efforts worked. The Republicans won the election by a margin of only 1/12 of 1%, or just under 1,800 votes. Despite the election win, Richards' experience would teach him that unethical behavior happens far too often in Washington, from all political parties.
One of the things that I observed in Washington was the great lack of integrity and ethics. It seems like everybody was out for themselves. Everything is me too. I want that, I will do what I have to do to get that, whether they act unethically or not.
Only one or two of all the colleagues I served with could you really call unethical or dishonest under the law. The major thing, they're wind testers, testing the wind. How do I look good? How do I impress people? What do I say?
I would occasionally meet a candidate who would like to hire us, and sometimes they would say, well, let's do a piece of survey research and find out what the people believe so I can determine what I should say and do. That candidate never was added to our client list. You begin with a candidate and his ethics. Unless you know what you stand for, you're going to get pulled off track.
You didn't have to second guess Dick Richards. You knew where he stood. He didn't come on and try to be all things to all people.
When I'm here, I don't care whether you like me or not. When I leave, I don't care if you like me. All I care is when I leave, you say, he was honest with me. I'm gonna give you honest answers, tell you the best I can, and that's the way it is. I'm not trying to win you over.
Dick always have an attitude of, what do I have to lose? In the worst case scenario, they'll fire me. What he stood for was more principle than the gain that could be achieved through any of those positions or opportunities.
It's interesting because most people would not really know who Dick Richards is. And that's an indication of what a good man he was and what a good job he did. Even as Republican National Chairman, Dick was never a political seeker of publicity.
As chairman, Richards handled the stress of Washington through a high standard of ethics that was admired and appreciated. His 2 years as RNC chairman would prove to be a great experience for him and for his family.
When I was chairman, I brought my whole family back to Washington. That, of course, was a great experience for them. They got to the White House, they got to visit the vice president's home in Kennebunkport, Maine. He invited us up. And, you know, the relationships that they had in Washington were just very growth promoting for them.
As chairman, Richards would select the site for the 1984 National Republican Convention and enjoyed spending a generous amount of personal time with the President of the United States.
We were always very friendly. He always called me Dick. I always called him Mr. President, but flew with him a couple of times on Air Force One, traveled with him a little bit to various parts of the country. I was very pleased to have as much time with him as I did.
In September of 1982, Richards crowned his political career by bringing President Ronald Reagan to visit his home state of Utah.
I was scheduled to introduce the president. And when we got there, the president went into a little tent area that they had for him, a holding area. And they played Ruffles and Flourishes, and the president came out and bounded up right onto the stage and got behind the microphone and got ready to speak. And this was the day that I was able to introduce the president of the United States to my family and my friends and my neighbors. And when he started to speak, I saw that great opportunity go away. So I walked up to him and tapped him on the shoulder and said, Mr. President, it isn't your turn yet.
Oh, I thought you had done it.
And he kind of threw up his hands and backed off. And then I got to introduce the president. The introduction is, ladies and gentlemen, the president of the United States.
Reagan, he had a way of getting both parties to get together. I'm sure he used some input from Dick Richards.
Thank you, Dick Richards.
He's authentic, and America needs more like him today.
Dick Richards decided not to seek a second term as chairman of the RNC. Before he left, President Reagan made arrangements to attend his farewell party.
I dropped by to say a few words, if I could, about a personal friend of mine. Back in 76, when we had an incumbent president, and I happened to be a challenger, Dick was the state chairman in Utah. And he put himself on the line, becoming the first state chairman to endorse me. I've never forgotten the courage and conviction that it took to do that. And Dick, I want you to know that I'll always be grateful.
One word you can't place on Dick Richards is phony. He was loyal. And a lot of times in national politics, that's not true. It's easier for people to hate than to love. They can tell me what they're against, but they really don't know what they're for. If you want to keep a republic, it is government by representation, then play the game and play it honestly and play it the way Dick Richards did.
One of the framers of the Constitution was asked, what kind of a government you have? And he said, a republic if you can keep it. And if we don't put honest people on this side and honest people on that side, you're going to get dishonesty in the management of the country, in the management of the issues. And you know, people ask me, well, what's ethics? How do you define ethics? It's simply doing the right thing. And I think every one of us can look at the situation and know what's the right thing to do. The question is whether we have the courage to do it.